Howdy folks and all the wonderful subscribers, it's me again, your Chief Edu Lancy. This video segment is a discussion about centrifugal pumps. I am supposed to do the discussion about all kinds of pumps in general, which means different pumps on board ship, including industrial pumps you can find ashore or at sea. However, since I have an upcoming lecture with a series of LPG cargo operations and the rest of the tankers lectures, especially on discharging operations, I just need to start with this subject. Let's begin. Before we dive in deeper, let's talk about the fundamentals of centrifugal pumps. We need to know its design, classifications. It is important to classify such pumps so that we could understand how it works. Let's look upon the classification based on the type of impeller used, the blow type, support fittings, and the stage type. Hence, once we establish the fundamentals, we would be able to know what are radial, axial, and mixed flow centrifugal type of pumps. At the end of this discussion, we will be able to categorize the support fittings such as overhang, between bearings type, including the impeller used such as closed type, open type, or semi-open type. And by definition, centrifugal pumps are used to transport fluids by the conversion of rotational kinetic energy to the hydrodynamic energy of the fluid flow. The rotational energy typically comes from an engine or electric motor. The fluid enters the pump impeller and along or near to the rotating axis is accelerated by the impeller, flowing gradually outward into a diffuser or volute chamber, or as we call it as casing. In layman's term actually, this centrifugal force is imaginary. It is the centripetal force that is actually real. The centrifugal force is just an imaginary force. But anyway, to give you a layman's description, if you are riding a motorbike or a vehicle at a passing speed and you are turning into a curve, into a road, which is taking a curve, then you will be able to feel the outward force that is actually pushing you or pulling you outward the curve. That force is what we call centrifugal force. Impeller type of classifications, these are poorly enclosed, semi-closed, or open. Now, there are different types of flow classifications. Centrifugal pumps are based on free flow system. They are classified into three, and these types are as follows: radial, axial, and mix. The first one, which is radial, is a very common type which can be seen on board ships, such as booster pumps, pumps that you can find on the oil tankers with a pump room, and also we can also see this in the common gas tankers or chemical tankers. But of course, at the same time, these are also a combination of radial and axial or mixed flow types, such as for the LNG, for the low-high duty compressors, they use the so-called radial and at the same time axial, so they call it mixed flow. And for the submersible LNG pump, we call it as axial type, and also a radial type, wherein a mixed flow, they put in a so-called inducer before the impeller, so that's what makes it as a mixed flow. The other type is, for example, is those who have been on board LPG gas carriers, deep well pumps. Deep well pumps, they utilize the so-called axial type or mixed types, which the impeller is actually on the bottom and it has an axial shaft is coming from the top and goes down to the bottom. And on the impeller, there are multi-stage impeller. For those oil tankers with a common pump room, since the tank is basically in line, or the level of the bottom of the tank is in line with the pumps, then they utilize a so-called single-stage impeller. So those are the different types. Okay, I'd like to discuss a little bit in this kind of conventional type of explanation. So we have two types of casing here, which is we call this one as volute type of impeller casing, and the other one is so-called vortex. Okay. And both of them are, of course, applicable or utilized in the so-called centrifugal pumps of equipments or pumping systems.
And basically, the volute type, if we differentiate them, the volute type, of course, the impeller is actually located somewhere a little bit off from the middle. This is the cross-sectional view of your so-called centrifugal pumps, while the vortex is actually just in the middle of the casing. Now, in this volute casing, you could see that the space here is a little bit closer to the casing side or linings, and as it goes out further, of course, the rotation is this way, and you'll be able to see that there is an increase of area in this section, and hereby we can say that the so-called pressure and the velocity is actually increased. So in principles, it's so-called potential energy. This is the eye of the impeller in the negative section, and of course the inlet is going through that direction, and as it goes out from the vanes of the impeller, the potential energy is converted to kinetic energy, and hence of course the area becomes bigger, and of course the Bernoulli's principle now is in effect, and of course with that we have now a positive flow of substance. In the vortex types, it's almost actually the same, except that of course the impeller is located in the middle, and of course it turns in the same direction. Now this type of application of pumps is mixed up with the so-called radial and axial flow of impeller. So meaning to say, most of it, they have included the so-called inducer. Sometimes they call it, let me just say, inducer. Or sometimes it's called as diffuser. Or in other pump system or even gas compressor to utilize LN, this centrifugal type, they even utilize this called IGB or inlet guide vane. Right, so before the impeller, or it could be also integrated with the impeller, is another sort of vanes. That is actually fixed or variable, meaning to say they could change the opening of that vanes before the impeller. And with that kind of fittings, what happens is that you are actually using the same principle here. The area in that section becomes smaller or bigger, depends on the how you are operating your pumps. But with that, you are actually again creating the so-called or applying the so-called Bernoulli's principle in your so-called centrifugal pumps. So I'm going to show this animation of Bernoulli's principle so that you could understand it better.
Now, to give you an overview, a radial is basically the same to what is shown in this 3D model. As you can see, the impeller is directly towards the plane of the inlet, the suction side or inlet, basically directly towards the plane of the impeller. And the outlet is perpendicular to the impeller rotational direction, or 90 degrees perpendicular to the pump shaft. Now let's tour you around with this so-called centrifugal pump. This is a radial type, and it uses a closed type impeller, just as you can see. And of course, you'll find there, this is the motor, and that's the shaft, and of course the skid, and of course the suction inlet, this one, as you can see. And of course you'll find there the discharge in outlet, right? And of course the volute casing. This is the volute casing, it's the old one. So this kind of volute casing is typically of a radial type, and as you can see the impeller, if I split the assembly and blown up the image, you'll find there the impeller. The direction of the turn will be counterclockwise because, as you can see, the blade of the impeller is in that kind of direction, going that way. Alright, so I'm gonna put it back again and I'm gonna turn the pipe. See? And this is another type of centrifugal system. Instead of liquid passing through this one, is gas actually. It's being utilized on board the LNG ship. They call it as high and low duty compressors, but the principles are the same. In this type, it uses a vortex type of impeller casing,
where, as you can see, it's the impeller is actually in the middle, and the outlet is also in the middle, and in the inlet is in the middle. And if I blown out the image or split the assembly, you'll find there the impeller. And of course, before the impeller is the so-called inlet guide vane, which is a variable inlet guide vane. So basically, this is a so-called axial and radial, or where we call it as mixed flow type of centrifugal system. So I'm gonna put it back, and as you can see, if we start it, that now as you can see also or notice that there is a bulkhead here, which resembles the separation of the electrical motor room and the compressor. But nowadays also there are systems wherein the motor and the pumps or compressor are actually in the same place without a bulkhead, and because they have already evolved with some technologies wherein the electrical is highly gas tight, just as the LNG submersible, there are actually submerged in the cargo tanks with the liquid in it. So yeah, but in most cases the typical or conventional types, they have a separate motor room separated by a bulkhead and a gas seal type. So there you go, the inlet goes here and it goes there. And of course, it produces from the negative suction in the middle, and then outward it creates a so-called from potential to kinetic energy, which is converted. And then, of course, you have now a high pressure, high velocity of flow of liquid or gases. So there you go. Now let's try to prove Bernoulli's principle using this animation, where it says if there is constant flow and change in area, then change in pressure and velocity will be the result. So as you can see here, we have a flow represented by the dots. We just take it off. Anyway, we know that the flow direction is from left to right. So now we assign a speed meter. Put it in here and also in here. Now as you can see, regardless where I put the speed meter, the velocity is the same because it's a constant flow. Then we assign a gauge pressure just before the speed meter. There you go. Then we adjust the diameter of the pipe, and what's out? You could well see that the velocity has decreased while the pressure has gone up. Try to adjust further, and the same thing. The pressure has gone up, the velocity has dropped down. Now we try to do the opposite. We decrease the diameter of the pipes, and as you can see, the velocity has increased while the pressure also increases. So in this way, in this principle, it's basically the same to what is going on with your centrifugal pumps and in the impeller and in the bullet casing. So what happens there is that in the center of the eye, you have a negative suction, and you can see that the area is increasing. And as it goes out through the bullet, the area increases. So what happens then is that as it goes out, the velocity drops down and the pressure goes up. And when it comes out to the volute area, then the velocity will go up and the pressure will also goes up. Now let's summarize the discussion and recapitulate some of the subject matter that I have mentioned in the introduction of this video. This is an overhang type impeller. As you can see, the volute casing is taken out just to simplify it. It has no other bearing coming out from the other side, but it's just one way from the other side. So there's the motor there. While in between bearings, it's basically you have one motor, and that of course that there are two bearings along the shaft of the impeller, and in the middle is you'll find the impeller. So you have two bearings that is holding it in place. Now this is an example of a multi-stage impeller. It's self-explanatory, as you can see. There are multiple impellers that are placed in the fittings. While the examples and demonstrations that I have mentioned or discussed in the earlier stages of this discussion are single stage type of impeller, because it's very obvious you could see only one impeller. And with regards to the suctions, as you can see here in the drawings, there are only two kinds or two types, single suction and double suction. And the drawing shows a lot, it's self-explanatory, so I do not need to further expound this kind of discussion. Now, if pressure falls below suction side of impeller, which is basically in the eye or center, in relation to the vapor pressure of the liquid, such as your cargo, then the liquid starts to bulge. Hence, bubbles will be produced. As such, the pump will begin to wobble, or what we call as cavitation. Over time, this could destroy the impeller, which is actually most common part to be damaged first within the assembly. Now, it occurs because there is not enough pressure on the suction end of the pump, or insufficient net positive suction head available, NPSHA. And this will be another discussion to be discussed with the general pumps in the next segment of videos that will be uploaded. So keep posted.